I think my first TV match is on, and again, this is, wouldn't recommend it, but Hollywood Bob Starr from Mid-East Wrestling Federation, MUF is what they called it. Yes, Hollywood Bob Starr. He was asked to bring in local talent from the Baltimore area. I had started training in 94, the summer of 94. I think before the summer of 95, so let's just call it spring, he had asked me to go do TV tapings for WCW. And I didn't belong anywhere near the ring, just so you know. I shouldn't have ever been anywhere near WCW or any type of televised professional wrestling. I will admit that right now.
So I'm going to put you on the spot here. June 6, 1995, the first record I have of you here on WCW television is you facing Meng with Colonel Parker at ringside.
Correct. And I remember pretty well knowing that I was shaking in my little boots.
Oh, I'm sure.
National TV, not even a year in the business. Maybe if you had to say, how many matches did you have by then? Maybe if I was lucky, 50, maybe. And there's good and bad news to that. Good news is I didn't have to do any offense. So in other words, so I didn't have to worry about doing anything really bad. But the bad news is Meng probably weighed 270 and I weighed about 175. So him not even trying to hurt me was extremely challenging because he could break me in half, to be totally honest with you. So, but yeah, I remember a few things. His chops were extremely painful. My hair was extremely big. I mean, my hair was like out to here. It was crazy Samoan hair. And I was really thin and I had a black singlet I bought at like the Sports Authority. Like I was so cheap. I mean, like I was, I mean, I looked awful. Like I had hair on my chest. I didn't know anything about hair in my armpits, thin as a rail, like just the worst looking human ever. And they're like, hey, go fight Meng. I'm like, whatever, you guys are crazy to even have me on this show. So, and he destroyed me in like 3 minutes, you know. There was more time of him, you know, either walking to the ring and Colonel Parker, you know, waving his little handkerchief and, you know, whatever he does after a match and laughing than it was of our actual match. But I do remember, and it was a super kick was the finish. And I can't even remember all that, but I do remember just how awful I looked on television at that moment in my life. So I wasn't prepared.
Yeah. Facing Meng that night. And then, the next night they had you in the ring against Johnny B. Bad.
Your memory's better than mine unless you're reading something from the internet.
This is history of WWE.com. You got to check the site out. It's got like ring results the whole way back to like the 60s.
Yeah, that's pretty insane. So yes, I wrestled Johnny B. Bad. And the only thing I remember about that is, and I think both these matches were probably filmed at Center Stage, which is Atlanta, Georgia. They would film WCW Saturday Night there and they maybe even filmed NWA Pro. And I'm not 100% sure. I don't think it was worldwide.
You were absolutely right here. You were absolutely
at Center Stage Theater. A while ago. But what I remember about Johnny Bad's match is, I think, again, not a lot of offense for me. So that was good because I wasn't prepared for doing anything special. I mean, yeah, on the indie shows, I may have had 50 matches. I may have thrown decent punches and kicks and may have executed wrestling moves. But I don't think I actually knew the ins and outs of properly wrestling professionally. I'll get to that a little bit later on how I learned more. But what was cool is I got to be on TV. And then the one thing I do remember is he gave me a Hurricane Rana. And when I tell you I'm not a properly trained pro wrestler, I don't care what anybody says. I started in 94 in the summer and I was doing my shows by the fall of 94 and wrestling through the winter of 94, 95 and the spring of 95. But by the time I got to this place, these TV tapings, I shouldn't have been there. And I'll admit it right now. And Bob Starr shouldn't have brought me down. And WCW probably shouldn't have said, dude, go out there and do these. I had to take a Hurricane Runner from the top rope, not knowing anything about the move. So imagine if you watch it today, there's always people standing around with their arms like this. And they're just, you know, doing that stupid thing they call like the alligator. Oh, I'm waiting to get the move. I didn't even know I had to do that. So imagine me. I'm so dumb. It looks real as hell because I literally just standing there and he jumps up, wraps his legs around my neck, and he does a backflip. He literally drives me DDT from the top rope right into the mat and just spikes my ass. And I don't know any better. He covers 1, 2, 3. When I get to the back, what they would call the gorilla, not that they had one at WCW, but whenever, everybody there, all the agents were like, oh my God, are you okay? And luckily I was like, yeah, man, I'm fine. They're like, oh my God, we thought he killed you. So again, didn't belong anywhere near.
They're probably like, this kid can sell. Like,
well, they did. Believe me, I got booked forever after that. So that was the beginning. So as horrible as I was, it's true. They were like, hey, bring that kid back. I'm like, what the hell, man? So Bob would, anytime he had a TV taping, Julio Dinero was going to either Atlanta, Georgia or Orlando when they started doing the WCW Pros and the Worldwides from Orlando. or they do the Saturday nights from Georgia. And sometimes we do what we do is a Saturday night in the center stage, and then they'd film their pros or their worldwides from a neighboring town, Dalton, Georgia, Dothan, Alabama, Augusta, Georgia. And they just go to some random arena where house shows used to be staged, and they would just stage tons of TV matches. So I got matches with like Brad Armstrong, and gradually I got better. So just to, I didn't say the worst wrestler ever. Right. No, but I mean, even so, just gradually. And what I did that was kind of crazy that Bob Starr wouldn't do for some reason, and it's no offense to him. When I was in Atlanta, I would go to the power plant. And I would go there and be like, let me go to this place. Because we would do our show. We would only be 2 hours from the next building, next town. So I'd go there in the morning from like 10 to like 2. And then at 2, I'd leave and go to the town we had to be in for the TV taping. And that helped a lot because they actually would watch me wrestle. And they were like, dude, what are you doing? And it wasn't that my moves were executed poorly. But when we'd get in the ring and just do wrestling moves, they were like, why would you do that? And I was like, I don't know. And they're like, why would you do that? And I was like, I don't know. And they're like, what do you mean you don't know? I'm like, whatever, dude. I'm kicking a guy. I'm throwing a forearm shiver. And yeah, but they explained to me that this is not just random wrestling move execution. And I picked up a lot from the power plant. So that was kind of where my brain flipped from wrestling move execution to kind of like a logical storytelling matchmaking, kind of whatever real pro wrestling is supposed to be. I picked it up from the power plant.